I'm not as tall as everyone else here, although I do try with the boots. So tonight I'm going to be telling you about my story, Manifesto Matters, which started in my first year at York University. And I was studying professional writing in the periodical stream, which is a really long-winded way to say I was studying journalism. But during my first year there, I took a lot of humanities courses at York, which taught critical thinking and some creative writing. And it was in one of these humanities courses that I was given the task to create a manifesto. And that was my assignment. So I was really excited about this idea. I went to the library and was researching manifestos that had been written and really trying to figure out what exactly I wanted to write about and what was most passionate to me and that I would have a really great manifesto. So I thought about it and I wanted to write something about Native issues. Although I am Native, I was actually raised in the suburbs in a Dutch household and grew up very apart from my culture. So I didn't really have my family or my culture or my traditions or my language in growing up. So it really wasn't until my first year at university at York where I really started to explore my culture and my identity. And it was through not only the amazing professors that I had there who sort of led me along that path, but also through the Indigenous arts community that I tapped into while I was living in Toronto. And so I decided that I wanted to write something about my Native culture. And of course, I was a big advocate for education as I was in my first year of university and was really excited about being able to get a degree and have a wonderful whole entire world open up for me after I did that. And my reserve, where I come from, is a very small reserve in the interior of British Columbia. And it's a very rural reserve, and it's also quite decrepit. So it's very similar to images that you might have seen of Attawapiskat in the last year or so. So it's a very sort of, there's no economy, it's a very depressed kind of place. And being that I was in the big city and my first year in university, I'm wondering, why don't all Native people go to school and leave their communities or try to access education in their communities and really just work hard and just try to get an education? And I decided that's what I was going to write about. So I went ahead and wrote my big manifesto and I brought it to the Center for Academic Writing. So I was getting tutoring during my first year just to make sure I was getting really good grades. I just wanted to do everything right. So I brought it to my tutor, who I'd been working with for at least half a year. And I gave her my manifesto and I said, you know, this is what I'm doing. Can you help me with that? Make sure it's polished and, you know, let's do a little couple edits here and there. And she looked at me. This woman was in her 50s and she was white. And she looked at me and she said, no, this is not acceptable. And what you've written here is not acceptable to hand in. And what you need to do is to go visit with an elder, or you need to go to the York University Native Student Association and start talking to, like, resource an elder through that. And I was astonished, and I just felt really hurt, and I didn't understand why I was being attacked for my viewpoints. Now, of course, many years later, I realized that there's many other issues that are surrounding access to education and all of that, but I was censored in that moment and was told that what I wanted to write was not acceptable, and I quickly left the meeting. I didn't stay there to take any more of what she had to tell me, and I left, and I'm pretty sure I was crying in the hallways or near close to crying in the hallways after I left that office, because I was basically told in that meeting that I wasn't Native enough to have this opinion and that I wasn't informed enough. And that is something that I have been dealing with for a very long time, especially in the last few years. I write a blog. It's called Urban Native Girl. It's about pop culture with an Indigenous twist. So I write about fashion and film and politics and beauty and these kind of topics that are really easy to write about and entertaining and a little bit more exciting. And I've been writing this blog for over 5 years, but it wasn't until recently that I realized that I had been completely avoiding the issue of politics, which stemmed from this meeting that I had with in my first year of university. And it wasn't until recently with the Idle No More movement that I really started researching and getting more engaged in political activity and social activity in Canada and with First Nations people, and really just researching so much. But I was scared to voice my opinion, and I didn't want to tweet anything. I didn't want to put anything on Facebook, and I was just really scared, and I didn't really know why. And it wasn't until The Guardian approached me and said, hey, would you like to write about Idle No More? And if you know The Guardian, you don't say no. You say yes, absolutely, I'll write about that. And thankfully, I'd been researching for a long time, and I felt comfortable with the material to be able to write my viewpoint. But it was a very challenging task, and I took a lot of time in crafting that piece to ensure that it was balanced, and I talked to other people about their opinions. And, you know, I wasn't able to write just off the cuff like I was when I was first year in university. And I don't know how much further I'll go into delving into politics. I think it's something that's very interesting and intriguing for me, but I'm still dealing with that initial censorship from my first year of university, and still, it's still coming out today. And it's something that I need to overcome and work on to be able to delve into that political arena a little more. But I wanted to share this story because it's amazing what impact small little things can have on you. And that I was really surprised to find that that still was resonating with me now. It's about 8 years later, and I'm still sitting with that woman standing across telling me you're not Native enough and your opinion, your voice doesn't matter. And I know that it does because I get a lot of good feedback from people, but I'm still fighting that battle now. And hopefully I will be able to overcome it soon, and I will have more pieces in places like The Guardian. Thank you.